You, let's start at the beginning. You grew up in ultimately a war zone during the war in Ireland. What was that like as a child?
It was a magical experience for me as a child. You know, the family around me, immediate family, they was wonderful people. It was quite normal, you know, in a sense, then, you know, through the eyes of a child. But, you know, I would see a lot of violence and different stuff going on, obviously. A lot of activity, riots, shooting. But, you know, through the eyes of a child then, you think this is normal.
So looking back now, do you recall any events from your time in Ireland that maybe started the path that you were going to lead that would have affected you mentally or impacted your childhood without realizing it at the time?
Looking back, because of the environment of the times, it was a kind of a place. The Irish are wonderful people. This is the first thing. They really are the salt of the earth. The division there was hard, you know, and really, really unfortunate, you know, because, you know, it's all the same people. But because of the divisions, you know, you had to watch what you said, who you talked to, who was listening, where you went, all these kind of things. Everyone was mindful of stuff like that. You know, and of course there was the army presence, and you know, there was all the violence and riots and checkpoints and things like that.
When I started reading your book, the part in which you talk about the young man that was shot in front of you, and ultimately died in front of you, held me in the room at the time I was reading it, trying to imagine what it was like to witness that. What impact did that have on you, or has that had on you?
This was massive. It really was. I mean, at the time, you know, it was terrifying, you know, for me as a child. It wiped me out, you know, emotionally as a child to have to witness something like that. I think the hardest part was having to stay there while he was dying and, you know, he's calling for his mother. That was traumatic, you know, it really was. And, to the point it stayed with me for many, many years, you know, and this in particular was one of them things that I locked away, you know. I didn't speak of this, certainly not in any detail to anyone, throughout my life till 6, 7 years ago.
You've also said, and this is also a line from your book, where you say that recalling your story for writing the book is like galloping through hell on horseback. Is that the sort of experience that you're referring to when you say that?
Yeah, I kind of was involved in violence, even by proxy, you know, from these kinds of incidences. But what I seem to do with my life is because I was cast out in many ways, you know, and had to fend for myself, you know, and you know, I made a lot of bad choices, you know. I didn't have the knowledge then. It is what it is. But I kept compounding that, and you know, I got involved in serious crime with serious people very, very early on. So this was a real pattern for me for most of my life, you know, until my transformation.
What age did you start committing crime, and what sort of crimes were you committing when you first started?
Very early, you know. I mean, you're talking 11 silly things like, you know, theft, stealing cars, getting chases from the police, and all this kind of stuff, Michael.
And recalling that back during that time, was it something that you, was it an adrenaline rush? Was it kind of reaching out for help? Was it a cry for help? What do you think is the purpose?
Looking back, I think it was both. You know, it was certainly the adrenaline rush of a young youth and a young man, the excitement of it, of course. But really, behind all this stuff, you know, even, you know, I'm always looking at what's behind, you know, what's the real stuff, you know. And it was certainly I was very lost even at that point. So there was a, you know, I was looking for direction, you know, the right instruction. I was looking for so much, which I, you know, I didn't have at that point. point in my life, certainly for a long time to come.
Yeah. You eventually moved back to England, didn't you, after your Auntie Madge passed away, who she raised you, right?
Yeah.
And when you moved back there, did you fall straight back into the same problems where you were kind of committing petty crime as a youngster?
You have to remember I was different. You know, I spoke funny. So, you know, I was different. I stuck out. I was a target. But I was popular in a sense. You know. I mean, obviously, I had my problems with that. But I, my answer, you know, was to do more and be more. You know, you have to think of the environment I come from was really different. So I was shaped really, really different anyway. So I always seem to be more, even than the children around me then. Have a much bigger bandwidth, Michael.
So it sounds like your focus was on survival, whether it be social, whether it be mental, whether it be for acceptance in any case. It sounds like survival was important to you. Was drugs ever a part of your childhood?
Unfortunately, yeah. I had addiction problems. You know, addiction problems, they exhibit themselves very, very early. They certainly did in my case. It was another layer of that feeling different from everyone else. You hear this from people who, you know, have had these problems on their journey. You know, I'm 11 years clean now, you know, of absolutely everything. And, you know, I'm very happy to say I've done a lot of work as a sponsor and helping people to save their life also in this area. But the reality of going through something like that for so long is horrendous, and not many people come back from it, Michael, unfortunately.
So when you were young, you were sent to what would probably now be known as a juvenile jail, essentially, in Borstal. What was it you were sent there for, and what was that experience like as a child? Because some of the stories I've heard are...
Yeah, I went to SEND. It was detention centre then, which was a short, sharp shock. So it was basically like signing up to an army camp. Everywhere was on the double. It was marching. It was, you know, all the people there was ex-forces. This was the focus there. And it was very violent. You know, kids of that age can be a lot worse than adults in adults' prisons. Some of the people I was there with would become very, very notorious later on, and I would go all the way through the prison system with them. You know, they'd be involved in the Tottenham riots and stuff like that. I mean, you know, some of the really, really notorious people of the time. They used to make us do mad things, Michael, like, you know, go out and... There was a corridor there. It was called the M1 for obvious reasons, you know, with these tiles. And they'd get us scrubbing that with a toothbrush. Lots of stuff like this.
Yeah, that's a lot of work.
Well, they'd done this for a reason. It was about discipline and, you know, all of this stuff.